Hello everyone, this lesson is about static electricity and Coulomb's law. We'll start with a brief historic background of the major milestones in the history of electricity. Now, all civilizations observed static electricity in the form of lightning in the sky. Of course, at that time, they did not know that lightning is associated with static electricity. In around 500 BC, Greeks observed that rubbed amber can cause electric shock when you approach it. They actually called amber electron, and when they rub it, they felt electric shock. Between 200 BC and around 600 AD, ancient Iraqis invented a wet battery, which became known as the Baghdad Battery. The Baghdad Battery is composed of a 5-inch long clay pot with an opening on the top. Through this opening, a foiled copper cylinder is fitted, and within the diameter of copper cylinder, an iron bar is inserted while keeping a small proximity between the iron bar and the copper cylinder so they don't touch. Now, the two metals are fitted on the top by a stopper made of cement. This stopper will keep the two metals from touching each other while suspended from the top of the jar. The hypothesis is that an acidic electrolyte is placed between the two electrodes that allows electricity to go through, consequently creating a battery. This acidic electrolyte could be grape juice, wine, or lemon juice. It's very similar to the idea of car battery. Your current car battery has sulfuric acid as electrolyte. This idea was tested by General Electric High Voltage Laboratory in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, where they reproduced the Baghdad battery and measured the voltage out of it using grape juice as an electrolyte. It produced 2-volt battery, which is more than any of the AA or AAA dry batteries. In 1750 AD, Ben Franklin proposed the presence of positive and negative charges. Ben Franklin proposed an experiment to prove that lightning is actually electricity. This experiment was carried out in France, where a pole was erected in order to harness the electricity of lightning. And this pole was inserted inside a glass bottle. When lightning hit the pole, it was noticed that approaching your finger, a shock was created between the finger and the pole, which indicates that electric charges pass through the pole from the lightning. The way Ben Franklin thought about it is that electricity is like a fluid, and whenever there is extra fluid, electricity is positive. Whenever there is lack of fluid, electricity is negative. And always this fluid is trying to go from the excess area, the positive area, to the negative area. So basically, he thought about electricity as flow of positive fluid to the negative area that lacks the fluid. Negative means lacks, positive means excess. So during the lightning, what happened, negative charges are going through the metal pole to the glass jar, giving it access of negative charges. When you touch it, the ground will provide positive charges, positive fluid, in order to balance the negative. And that's why charges will accumulate on the glass jar, the positive charges, in order to try to get to the negative charges. But the glass is insulator, it will not allow this positive fluid, this positive charges, to go through the glass insulator, so it will just accumulate there. And whenever you come and touch the metal pole with your finger, you are attracting the negative charges in the fluid, and this will cause the spark. Around 1789 AD, Charles D. Coulomb determined the force between static charges quantitatively, whether they are like charges or unlike charges. The equation basically states that the force between any two charges, Q1 and Q2, is equal to the product of those two charges divided by the distance square between the centers of those two charges. This equation is very much similar to the force between two masses. The major difference here is that the force of gravity is always attraction, while the force of electricity could be attraction or repulsion. Like charges repel each other, while unlike charges attract each other. And the constant K, as opposed to G in the case of gravity, is very big value. It's 9 times 10 to the power 9 newton meter square over Coulomb square. Other than that, we have the same relationship between force and distance, where the force is inversely proportional to the distance square, meaning if you double the distance, the force will decrease by 1/4. It's the inverse square law that we talked about in the case of gravity. And you can go back to lesson number 6, part 3, where we talked about the inverse square law in detail. In 1800, Volta produced continuous electricity, which is electric current. He actually developed the first dry battery. Volta was able to produce continuous electricity, which we call it electric current, by studying metals and discovering their ability to conduct electricity and to produce electricity in the presence of electrolyte. Volta placed two coins that are made of from different metals with a silver spoon on the top of them, and he was able to taste electricity. He concluded that electricity comes from metals when placing two metals on the top of each other with the presence of electrolyte between them. Keep in mind that at that time the makeup of the atoms was not known yet. Scientists did not know about the presence of positive and negative charges inside the atoms. And when Ben Franklin talked about positive and negative charges, he talked about it in the context of lacking electricity and excess of electricity. Positive means there is a lot of electricity, and negative means lack of electricity. The presence of positive and negative particles was not discovered. Now, Volta's predicament was how to make electricity strong, because the electricity he got out of the metal coins and the silver spoon was very weak. Volta went back and studied the electric torpedo fish, and he noticed the repeating pattern of chambers on its back. He thought maybe each chamber could very much represent one unit. So by repeating these chambers over and over again, the electricity will be multiplied. And maybe the same thing applies on his metal coin and silver spoon. So he decided to build his own version of the electric torpedo fish using zinc and silver while placing a paper soaked in salt and water to provide the electrolyte between the two metals. This is a schematic of what we call the Voltaic Pile, where Volta placed a silver plate and zinc plate, those represent the metal, and between them is a paper soaked in salt and water. And he repeated this pattern over and over again. This is an individual unit here, just made of silver. The red cylinder here represents silver. The blue one represents zinc. And between them is the electrolyte, water, and salt. This is a depiction of the Voltaic pile using copper here. So he took copper plate, placed a cardboard that's soaked in salt and water, and then placed a zinc on it. And he repeated this pattern over and over again, as you see here, creating what's known as the Voltaic pile, which is very much a strong battery, and it provided very strong electric current when he tested it. Now, the major significance of Volta's experiment is that electricity produced by his Voltaic pile is continuous, meaning it did not stop, unlike static electricity, where after the spark, electricity will drain. And that's because in the case of static electricity, the charges are static, they don't move. While in the case of continuous electricity that was produced by the Voltaic pile, the charges are continuously moving, and that's what we call the electric current. So this was the first time scientists produced electric current. Subsequently, as a result of this invention, electric circuits were created. In 1820 AD, a major invention was discovered based upon electric current. Is that electric current is not only electricity, it actually can create magnetism. And that was discovered by Hans Oersted. Hans Oersted created electric current through a wire. When he brought the electric wire close to a compass, he noticed that the electric current was able to apply force on the compass, hence deflecting it. And since we know that magnets are only affected by magnets, like poles repel each other and like poles attract each other, it was only reasonable to conclude that there is a magnetic field associated with electric current, meaning moving charges produce magnetic field. And this was very important discovery. Its implications are very wide, from the invention of electric motors, electric fuses, microphones, and so on. In 1875, J.J. Thomson identified cathode rays as an electron flow. And we'll cover this part more in the chemistry, where this experiment discovered that actually atoms are made of negative charges and positive charges, and they are not simply solid balls. Instead, atoms are divisible, meaning they have smaller particles inside them. And in 1911, Rutherford discovered the positive nucleus of the atoms, and now we know that the source of electricity came from those negative charges electrons, while the positive charge inside the atom is not involved in chemical reaction. So now the way we understand static electricity after we know what we know about atoms is basically static electricity is built up of electric charges on the surface of materials. Now what causes static electricity is heat. When you rub materials, you produce heat. And this heat gives kinetic energy to the charges, which enable them to move from one object to another, depending on the affinity of those objects to charges. We see the implications of static electricity in our daily life, from static length of, for example, balloon to the wall, the flyaway here, you feel electric shock when you approach a doorknob, which is also the same reason we see lightning, buildup of charges in clouds that cause the excess charges to discharge. And all that come from atoms, because atoms are made of electrons that are negative and nucleus that is positive. In normal conditions, electrons and the positive protons are balanced, they have the same number. But whenever there is energy, the electrons could be lost, leaving behind a positive ion with net positive charge. And those electrons that are lost will be gained by another object, hence it will become negative ion. You can see here a simulation of how static charges build up. You can see here a sweater, balloon, and the wall. And they are all neutral, meaning the number of positive charges is equal to the number of negative charges. Now what happened here if I take the balloon and drop it against the sweater? You can see here the balloon has gained negative charges because rubbing produces energy. Hence the electrons in the sweater will gain this kinetic energy, and this will enable it to overcome the attraction of the positive charges and hence move to the balloon. The balloon has affinity to attract electrons more than the sweater, that's why it will gain those negative charges. So now the balloon is negatively charged while the sweater is positive, and hence the balloon attracts the sweater. So this is implication of static electricity. Now what will happen here if I bring the balloon close to the wall? Now notice the wall is neutral while the balloon is negative. As the balloon approaches the wall, the negative charges on the wall is being repelled. So now the positive charges in the wall getting closer to the balloon, and therefore the wall will be able to attract the balloon. It's the same idea when you have a comb and bits of paper. When you approach the comb to the bits of paper, nothing will happen because both of them are neutral. But now if you comb your hair, friction will take place between the comb and the hair, and that causes charges to transfer between the hair and the comb. So now the comb is charged and now it's able to attract the bits of paper. So this is basically the same concept. The balloon that was wrapped against the sweater was able to charge the wall and get attracted to the wall. The same thing that happened to the wall will happen to those bits of paper, which is basically charging by induction. The balloon was able to induce positive charge here on the wall by repelling those negative charges. And most probably those negative charges can be grounded, while the positive charges will stay there because they are attracted to the negative charge of the balloon. Now, if you go back to the Coulomb's law, which we addressed briefly, Coulomb's law investigates the factors that impact the force of static electricity, that force that causes unlike charges to attract each other and like charges to repel each other. According to Charles D. Coulomb, the force between charges depends on two factors, the product of the amount of charge, which is the multiplication of the charge of the first object times the charge of the second object, and the distance between the two charges. The bigger the charge, the bigger the force. And the bigger the distance, the smaller the force. As you see, the distance has strong impact because it's squared. So now if we go back to the balloon and the wall, notice here that although the wall has the same positive and negative charges, so Q is the same for the positive and the negative, but the reason the negative charges on the balloon attract the positive charges on the wall more than its repulsion to the negative charges on the wall is because of the distance. The positive charges on the wall are closer to the balloon than the wall's negative charges. Again, the wall is neutral, so the negative charges here are equal to the positive charges, but the distance will tip the balance here and cause attraction.